for the YouTube APIs. And you're probably wondering why I have a green screen behind me. Well, today we're taking you behind the scenes with Capella's live streaming solution to show you some of their features. One of them actually is switching out backgrounds in near real time. So I'll switch over to introductions. Iku, you're the CEO of Capella Systems. Mm-hmm. And then we have Martin, who's one of the lead engineers. So let's jump right into it. Tell us a little bit of a background on your company.
So Martin and I, we started this company back in 2009. Prior to starting Capella, we were both members of a company called Rosette, which focused on offering offline transcoding software. At Capella, we focus on live streaming solution for professionals and also enterprise level customers. We also offer offline transcoding solution, mainly focused on H.264 compression technologies.
Okay, cool. So I guess the question is, from your last company to this one, what got you into the idea of doing this live streaming, or why did you decide to go into it?
At the previous company at Rosette, we focused a lot, mainly catering to post-production houses and mainly broadcasters. So we sold a lot of offline transcoding solution. As we were doing it, I saw a big shift going from traditional broadcasting workflow to more using open platforms like a live streaming. So we wanted to develop a software that is specifically designed for this kind of new type of broadcasting that's emerging today.
So then your goal is really to make live streaming easy to use and mm-hmm. very simple.
And our software allows users to do that. Our goal is to basically offer a very reliable software that allows users to do a whole production on his own or her own.
Okay, that makes sense. I guess, what are some of the common issues you see with live streaming just in general?
I think live streaming, the whole production, it could get very complicated. I see a lot of users trying to use multiple equipments, and then sometimes the combination of, for example, using particular capture board with a live streaming solution, you will face a lot of unexpected issues that are very difficult to troubleshoot. Mm-hmm. And also to do a very good live streaming show, you do need a lot of operators who are familiar with this kind of things, and it's very hard to arrange somebody to always be on site to do that. And my goal when we started this company is to create a software even for non-broadcasters are able to use this, for example, like schools, hospitals, like community groups and corporates. Anyone with just a little bit of IT background is able to use this software and do a very high quality streaming show on her own or his own. So.
Okay, and then so why did you choose the YouTube APIs using the live streaming API particularly?
Because we do believe that with the availability of fast internet and also like, you know, open platforms like YouTube, I see a lot of professionals and also even broadcasters are getting into live streaming and using YouTube live platform as a way to deliver more streams and contents to more viewers around the world. So I wanted to make it easier for those customers to be able to use our software that interfaces with the YouTube platform seamlessly.
Okay, well, great. So you guys were actually at Google I/O. You were in the YouTube sandbox, and you're showing off some of the cool stuff you're going to be showing now.
Yep.
So let's just jump right into the demo so we can have a look at some of the features and then do the green screen shenanigans.
Okay.
I've been talking about in our posts.
Okay. Great. Let's take a look. So here, this is our Cambria Live UI. On the very left-hand side, you will see a list of sources. So we can take in multiple camera inputs. For example, we have a camera one basically pointing at Jeremy, mm-hmm. and we have another camera that's pointing to us from different angle. So while you're doing streaming, I can switch in between different camera inputs. Another neat thing about our application, it comes with a function called VC. So I can add virtual camera inputs.
Yeah,
so
this is really interesting.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like you just have one camera that's taking a large HD shot of everything, and then you can kind of cut out a whole bunch of virtual cameras
right.
that you can switch between, right?
Yeah. The whole idea is just to use a single camera. We could kind of create this virtual multi-camera environment. So, you know, it reduces the cost of operation, and you only have to buy one camera. So right here, I am manipulating captured area, so I have this segment that's focused on me.
Mm-hmm.
So then doing a streaming, I can go from overview shot to VC. So it looks as though, you know, we're actually switching the camera inputs, but we're only really using a single camera input.
Okay, well that's pretty neat.
And also, so on here, you will see the list of targets that we can stream to. We can stream to Adobe Flash Media Server, Wowza. Of course, we can go to YouTube. So if you have a YouTube Live account, it will bring up a list of live events that you can register. You have been registered from YouTube website.
Okay, and so if for people that are larger that are doing these live shows, is there a way that they can claim or monetize against these?
Yeah, so we are in the process of integrating partner API. I think now it's called Content ID API. So from application, actually from offline transcoding software, user is going to be able to set claim options and also create reference files to be uploaded to Content ID system of Google that creates a bunch of fingerprint files.
Okay, great. And then on the ad side, you guys are looking into adding that as we speak, adding some of the functionalities for ad slates and ad insertions.
Yes,
and things like that.
We are in the process of implementing this feature. We believe that this kind of function will be very appealing to a professional and also enterprise level customers.
Great.
So if you have a YouTube account, then you can specify which channel that you want to stream to from here. And while you're doing live streaming to YouTube channel, for example, you could record an entire event to a file. So you can use it for archiving or for VOD.
And don't you guys have a feature where you can, as you're doing it, just take out the highlights? So
yes, so this is one of the cool features that we have. We have this function called Cambria Live Edit, which basically allows you to do proxy editing while you're doing streaming. So you can set multiple in and out point to create highlight clips. And that segment can be transcoded into multiple different file formats. And for example, can be uploaded to YouTube VOD channel.
Okay, great. Mm-hmm. So as you're having the live event, you can be kind of setting up a much smaller video with the highlights.
So now going to the green screen demo, we are going to do this by using a picture-in-picture function. So this kind allows you to combine multiple video layers into a single stream. So for example, I have...
So I know you guys are going to bring this up. Mm-hmm. And this was pretty popular at our sandbox. And I also have your app, which I don't know if you can see it here, but this is an app running on a Nexus 10. And you can see here, this is what they were showing, and you can actually click. So let's say I'm in space now, but I want to be underwater. I just click and see it takes me now to an underwater. So this is using your APIs, correct?
Yeah, this is using the API. So from this app, we can retrieve the first image of the different video files that are loaded into the application. Okay. And then when you click here on the tablet, it sends a message to our REST API, which triggers a switch of the background.
Yeah. Yeah, this is really cool. And of course, our favorite YouTube dev sticker.
And then this is all happening in real time. We're doing all this processing only by using our software. So it's a very powerful tool.
Yeah, and it's pretty fun to do. So now we're underwater.
Yes.
So let's jump into the technical details. Why don't you tell me, now you use a couple different languages, from my understanding. On the front end, you're using, what language are you using?
On the front end, we're using C#.
Okay.
We're using WPF from Microsoft to do the UI. So that's pretty simple to use. It's really productive to use. There's a lot of libraries. It makes it really simple to create UIs that look nice and are functional. Then on the back end side, where we do all the video encoding, all the video processing, the audio processing, that's using C++. Mm-hmm. For that kind of thing, you need a high performance language. You also need something where you have a lot of control over memory allocation, garbage collection, and so on. And also all this technology is also cross-platform because it's C++.
And then you guys are going even deeper than that in some situations,
yes.
Right?
Yes. So in some cases, we're going to use assembly language. For example, for that green screen we're showing right now, we use an assembly function to assembly code to composite yourself over the background that we're switching. And also to do things like upscaling video, downscaling video for very precise operations. It's done in assembly language.
Great. So So I guess you guys are using Oauth 2, obviously, with the new APIs. So how are you doing that?
So from the UI, we just launch a browser window where you enter your Google credentials. And then after that, we grab the refresh token. And that gets stored on the client machine. And then whenever we need to authenticate again, we create a new token from that refresh token.
So it's all in the local machine.
Yeah.
OK, great. Were there any, I guess, surprises not only with the API, but with customers using your product that you noticed?
Well, one of the surprises was when we moved to the new API, which is V3. Mm-hmm. Well, it was a pretty big change from the previous one. And we just started working with you guys. So we never know, you know, typically APIs tend to stay more similar through time. Mm-hmm. But this one for V3, there was a really big change, a really big, things became simpler. And also one of the other big change was that previously, if we wanted to stream in multiple bit rates and resolutions, we had to ourselves and our machine encode at all those different target bit rates. And now we can just encode at the highest bit rate that we want users to be able to see. We send that to YouTube, and then YouTube actually takes care of the transcoding for the lower bit rates.
Right.
So now you don't need a machine that's as powerful as what you needed previously.
Yeah, so we built it. Yeah, we basically rebuilt it from the bottom up with our new infrastructure. So that's why we definitely wanted to make some improvements. So that's why the new version is a little bit different than the last version.
And then also something that's surprising from our users' point of view is, well, the users that we're seeing, like, there are so many different cases. At first, we thought this would be used, you know, mostly by broadcasters or people at least fairly familiar with broadcasting. But we're seeing, you know, education conferences,
hospitals, or even like small community groups or corporates, like, you know, this. They're wanting to do a very high quality video streaming, but yet they don't really have an in-depth broadcasting background. So a very simple software like this helps them to do that.
So you actually, with this new version, you have some clients using this now successfully out in the field.
Right. We have a customer in Tokyo. It's a broadcasting company, Tokyo MX. They're using Cambria Live to stream all their music and also sports events to their YouTube Live channel. Here locally, we have Saver Cats, which is an indoor football team.
Oh, yeah.
Out of San Jose. They use us to do all the streaming of their games. I recently did a project in Seoul, worked with one of the biggest broadcasters in Korea. They did streaming of new music live events, streaming to their YouTube Live channel. So we do have quite few customer cases. We're already using it, so it's a proven case that it's working fine. They're very happy with it, and we're starting to see more and more installation, not only in the US, but all around the world. So we're very excited and happy about that.
Yeah, I was going to say, you're listing every country, it's quite a few countries, so that's really good to hear. I guess, is there anything you'd like to see added or you're looking forward to integrating with?
Well, something that we want to do more of is those Android apps like you were showing before. There's a whole bunch of different cases where that could be useful, since we need to build our application to be generic and used by many people. So in a bunch of instances, you'd be better off with a specific app. So if you have a lot of sources and you need to switch with them, then you'd want to have small thumbnails on the Android app so you can switch easily.
Mm-hmm.
Other cases, if you think about education, you would have the professor in front of the class. And using an app, you can change from your PowerPoint presentation or the DVI from your laptop to the camera itself that shows the classroom. So that's something that we want to pursue in the near future. And then, yeah, we're looking forward to whatever APIs you guys come up with, and we'll check them out.
Yeah, we'll definitely be talking more. Mm-hmm. Well, let's see if we had any questions for you guys. So it doesn't look, there was a question, so we usually have general questions. Okay. There wasn't any specific to Capella. There was a question around private videos, and you can upload, just for the people out there, you can upload a private video, and only you can see it, and then you can add a couple users. We do have a limit, but you can add a couple users so only they can see it. And of course, you can't download it unless you upload it and you own the content. And then the last question is always on our side, is YouTube developer relations hiring? And yes, we are. Definitely go check out the developers at google.com/hiring and have a look there to see if any positions interest you, because we're definitely looking for people. Well, thanks again, not only for coming today, but also for participating in Google I/O at the YouTube Sandbox. It was a really neat event, and we were really happy to have you guys. And we look forward to everything we can do now in the future with the live streaming API.
Thanks for having us today. It was great to see you and to be here.
Thanks.
Thank you.